W.F. Howes presents an unabridged recording of The Bear's Blade by Tim Hodkinson, narrated by Richard Everley. Prologue. Frodisborg, in the folksland of Gandvik, Norway, AD 935, late summer. Einar wondered if he was drowning. Like a man sunk deep underwater, he felt like he was wrapped up in coldness. All noise was muffled and indistinct, and he had the sensation he was sinking into darkness. When he closed his eyes, strange dreams took over his mind. When he woke, pain throbbed in his eyes and head. He felt freezing cold one moment, then boiling hot next. All the strength in his body had drained from him, leaving him weak, tired, and sick. Confusion fogged his thoughts. Where was he? Why did he feel this way? What had happened to him? He heard voices. They seemed familiar, but very far away. With an effort he found similar to the one that he had once needed to swim clear of a sinking ship, Einar forced his mind to wake. He opened his eyes and felt the stab of pain behind them. He was in a gloomy room, and it was dark, though a whale oil lamp burned somewhere nearby. Its glow cast an orange light on the faces of the people gathered around him, and its stench caused his stomach to lurch. There was a man leaning over him. He had his hand on Einar's sweat-soaked forehead. The man's skin was dark, almost black. For a moment, Einar thought he was back in one of the weird dreams that haunted him, then remembered it was the man they called Surt, King Eirik Bloodyaxe's former ringfighter and slave, who now sailed with Ulrik's crew of Ulfhethnar, the wolf-coated warriors of Odin. Behind Surt loomed the figure of an old man with long white hair and beard that cascaded around his chest and shoulders. As he regarded Einar, he leaned his chin on the backs of his hands that was placed on the top of a long walking staff. Einar wondered if he were dead, and perhaps this was Odin himself, come to take him to the next world. Then his reasoning mind saw that unlike the one-eyed god of the gallows, this man had two good eyes. It was Grimnir, the wise old man from Gandvik, who had sailed with Einar and the Wolfcoats on several of their expeditions.
"His wound has festered,"
Surt said, looking down at Einar's right hand. He spoke the Norse tongue, but with an accent that came from the hot, burning lands that lay far to the south. Einar's right hand was maimed, the little finger gone, and the palm sheared off. The wound was purple and black. Pus oozed from where his finger had once been. The flesh of the rest of the hand was swollen and angry red.
"How do you know?" Grimnir said.
"Warriors of Al-Andalus all have some training in the crafts of healing,"
Surt said.
"Armies lose more men to wounds that rankle than to killing blows." "We know woundcraft too," another voice said.
The sharp-featured face of Ulrik, the short, wiry leader of the Ulfhethnar crew, came into view. He wore the pelt of a wolf as a cloak around his shoulders. His dark brown hair was shorn short, revealing that, even though he was not an old man, it was receding from his forehead.
"Surt is right. The wound has gone bad."
Surt lifted his hand away from Einar's forehead. It was slick with the young man's clammy sweat.
"The poison runs throughout his blood, making him sick," Surt said. "It's clouding his mind, and has already stolen his strength."
"I knew there was something wrong when we sailed away from Orkney," a woman's voice said. She stepped into the light of the lamp. Like Ulrik, she wore a wolf pelt cloak around her shoulders. Even in the soft glow of the oil lamp, her skin appeared so pale it seemed pure white. Her red gold hair was tied in a short braid. A pair of very dark eyebrows arched over eyes so green they would not have looked out of place on a cat. Einar knew her too, Though she had all the appearance of a Valkyrie, she was not one of the shield maidens Odin sent flying over battlefields to pick those who had died in the bravest of ways. She was a Freka, daughter of the King of Dublin, and a wolf coat like him and the rest of Ulrich's crew. "He went very quiet and huddled by himself under the prow of the ship," she said. "I thought he was just angry and brooding."
"That's understandable," Grimnir said. "He fought his own father to the death. He won, but got that wound in the duel. Then he was forced to leave the high seat of Jarl's guard just after having won it. It must all have been hard to take."
The others all nodded. "And you know what Einar's like," Afreka said. "He always overthinks everything. Will he get better?" Her eyes flicked towards Surt. The dark-skinned man shrugged.
"Perhaps," he said. "Perhaps not. Who can say? Only Allah knows the answer to that. But he's a young, strong lad. He has a lot to fight the poison with. With time, care, and attention, he might pull through." "Those are the three things we can least afford to give him,"
Ulrich said.
"We have to leave him here."
Einar tried to speak, but his throat felt dry and swollen. All that came out was an incoherent croak.
"Einar is one of our wolf pack, Ulrich."
Skar, the big prowman of the Ulfhethner crew and Ulrich's right-hand man, said.
"He is an oath-sworn brother. We can't just leave him behind. Right now, he's also too sick to travel,"
Surt said, meeting Skar's intense gaze with his own.
"If we take him with us, we'll kill him for sure."
"Why can't we wait until he's recovered enough to move?" Afreka said.
"Because, your high and mightiness,"
Ulrich said, glaring at Afreka over clenched teeth.
"In case you haven't noticed, the world is at war with itself. The powers of chaos are loose. Brothers fight brothers, sons fight their fathers. Towns are being put to the sword and the flame. Whole folklands are being ravaged."
"What's that to us?" Wolfhelm, the Saxon with his long straight moustache, asked. Like Surt, he too spoke the Norse tongue with an accent, but his was of the West Saxons who lived in Britain.
"There are Vikings pillaging along the western coast of Norway. They were sent here across the northern whale road by Eirik Bloodyaxe," Ulrich said. "We may have held hack on chase Eirik out of this land, but if we don't do something more, Eirik will be back, and Hakon will lose the kingship again."
"Then we're all dead," Skar said, pursing his lips.
"War is our work," Ulrich said. "It's what we do, and King Hakon has need of our skills. We cannot waste time sitting around waiting for Einar here to either get better or die. Eirik Bloodyaxe will not be sitting on his ass, I can assure you of that."
"But Eirik is in Orkney now," Afreka said. "He ran there like a whipped dog when he was driven out of Norway."
"Do you think a man like Eirik will just accept that?"
Ulrich said.
"No. He's in Orkney now, licking his wounds, yes. But I know Eirik. After all, we were his sworn warriors for years until the bastard betrayed us. He'll be rebuilding his strength. And when he's ready, he'll be back. I don't want to be sitting here playing healer woman to a sick lad when he comes. He's too dangerous a foe to allow him to come to us. We need to make sure Hakon is safe from him too."
The members of his crew nodded, stroked their chins or otherwise showed their assent.
"Besides all that," Ulrich said, "can you not see what is happening? Any of you?"
He looked at those around him. The short man's eyes were now wide, bright, and glittering.
"There has been no summer," he said, when no one answered him. "Winter has just continued on when summer should have come. Rain, cold wind, grey skies, and no warm sun to ripen the crops. The harvest will fail. That will cause more war. Think about it. War and back-to-back winters. What do three winters with no summer herald?
Again, no one responded. In the resulting silence, Einar finally managed to find his voice.
A time of axes. A time of swords. Shields will be sundered, he chanted,
his voice hoarse and croaking.
A time of howling winds. A time of wolves. Then the world falls. No man has mercy for another.
The effort was too much for him. Einar groaned and closed his eyes once more.
Even this dying lad knows what I'm talking about,
Ulrich said, a look of fervid triumph on his face.
Don't you see it yet?
Ragnarok,
Afreka said. Her voice was hushed, little more than a whisper.
The end of the world,
Skar said, his tone equally daunted.
The final battle is coming, Ulrich said. Time is running out. Soon, Odin will send his Valkyries to pick those who will fight with him on the last day. We only have a little time to make sure we've done deeds great enough to be chosen for his army.
Afreka smiled and shook her head. This company have already done more than enough to grab Odin's attention, she said.
But what if someone does something to outshine everything we've done?
Ulrich said.
In times of war, folk have no end of opportunities to impress the gods, and the benches in Odin's Valor Hall only have room for a certain number of heroes. I don't intend to let someone take mine.
Perhaps you're right, Grimnir said. And King Hakon needs your help regardless. It's best you go. I will stay here in Frodisborg and look after the lad Einar here. My house is here, and besides, you must travel fast. I'm an old man and will only slow you down.
If Einar survives, Ulrich said, he can rejoin us. But in case he doesn't, leave him his Ulfbert. If he has one of the best-made swords in the world in his hand when he dies, perhaps Odin will turn his good eye blind to the fact the lad died in bed instead of on the battlefield.
He left the room. The others began filing out after him. Afreka lifted Einar's sword from beside his bed and unsheathed it. The blade shimmered in the lamplight as she ran her finger along the runes set into the middle of the blade, spelling out Ulfbert, the name of the wizardsmith who forged it. She stooped over Einar. Even in his daze, he could sense it was her. He felt the back of her fingers stroke down his cheek. Then she pushed the hilt of the sword into his uninjured left hand. Einar's fingers closed around it in a feeble grasp. Afreka closed her eyes. As Odin took 9 rune sticks and cut the poisonous serpent into 9 parts, she said in a whisper, may this poison be driven from you and never more enter the house of your body. Get better, Einar, son of Thorfinn the Skullcleaver. If you don't, I'll come back here and kill you myself. Then she too was gone. Too weak to move or speak, Einar drifted off once again into the nightmare-haunted darkness.
Part 1. Norway. Chapter 1. Frodisborg. 6 weeks later. The fight was lost and Einar knew it. His opponent knew it too. Einar cursed, spat, and moved sideways, hefting his shield so it was still between him and the warrior facing him. Sweat stung his eyes. His breathing was heavy. His shoulders were sore and his arms felt as if the shield he bore was made of stone. His opponent had not even broken sweat. He crouched, peering over the top of his shield at Einar. His sword was ready.
The eyes behind the helmet visor were alert and eager, watching for the opportunity to strike.
The warrior sprang forwards. Their shields collided with a crash of lindenwood. Einar felt his left foot, braced behind him against the impact, skid backwards. The other man swung his sword in an overhead blow, scything through the air in an arc intended to finish somewhere about halfway through Einar's head. Einar threw his own sword up to block it. With a clang of metal on metal, the blades met. Einar felt the hilt of his sword twist in the weakened grip of his injured right hand. A cry of dismay escaped his lips as the weapon fell from his grasp. It bounced off the rim of his shield and clattered to the ground. With a heavy sigh, he lowered his shield. What was the point in continuing? His opponent gave a low chuckle. The warrior drew his sword back to strike. He stepped closer, then pushed the blade forwards, poking Einar on the chin with the tip. "You're dead," he said, his face breaking into a grin. Einar cursed again, tossing his shield to the ground with a petulant shrug. "I'm useless, Bursi," he said, shaking his head. "With this injured hand, I can't grip anything properly." "Don't be too hard on yourself," Bursi said. He pulled his helmet off, revealing the face of a young man whose blonde hair was plastered to his head with sweat. "You did well, considering." Einar shot a sharp glance of reproach in his direction. He looked down at his maimed right hand. The thumb and first three fingers were fine, and he had recovered from the poisoning from his festered wound. But the hand was now ended after his ring finger. Grimnir, the wise old man who had nursed him through his sickness, had been forced to remove more septic flesh to save Einar, so now not only was his little finger gone, but his palm was sheared off almost to the wrist. Grimnir had been forced to cut away some of the flesh at the bottom of Einar's ring finger, making it hard to move. The wound was now covered by new, clean skin, which at least was a healthy pink instead of the rotting purple that had been there before. They stood in the meadow beyond Frodisborg, the little village on the edge of the fjord of Garnvik in western Norway. Both Einar and the other man's helmets and shields were usable war gear, but the swords were blunted practice weapons. They were little more than flattened iron bars used in training for real combat. Einar opened and closed what was left of his right fist. "Considering your wound, I mean," Bursi said. He was a young lad from the village, who Einar had asked to spar with him to test if his warcraft capabilities had recovered yet. Einar made a face. "Did your father grant you a legacy, Bursi?" he said, then realized it was a stupid question. The lad's father, one of the village fishermen, was still well in the prime of life. The lad returned Einar's gaze, confusion portrayed all over his face. "Well, my father bequeathed this to me," Einar said, spreading his remaining fingers. "It was his parting gift. I killed him just after he dealt me this blow." Einar saw the shock in the young lad's eyes and knew he had to explain further. "He killed my mother," Einar said. "He tried to kill me several times. We weren't what you might call a close family. When I killed him, I took the right to sit in his high seat as Jarl of Orkney. Then I lost that too." Bursi shook his head. "You know what, Einar," he said, a smile of admiration on his lips. "When I listen to your tales, I sometimes think I'm hearing the saga of some legendary hero like Sigurd Volsung or Rolf Kraki, not the life of a lad who's only a couple of years older than me. I'm nearly 18 winters old. I've lived all my days in this sleepy little village where nothing ever happens except fishing and harvest. You've experienced so much more. You've sailed the whale roads, been to cities, met with jarls and kings, fought in battles." "It's not true that nothing happens here," Einar said. "There was a battle in this very meadow not that long ago. We fought Eirik Bloodyaxe's bastard son here when he came to burn down the village." "And I even missed that," Bursi said. "I was away at sea on a fishing voyage with my father." "Well, be careful what you wish for, lad," Einar said, aware that all of a sudden he was talking to someone almost his own age,
as if he himself was an ancient wise man. Just over a year ago, I was on my mother's farm in Iceland. I was just like you, thinking I was at the very edge of Middle Earth where nothing ever happens. Then I got into a fight, was exiled from my homeland, and found out I had a father I never knew about who also wanted me dead. You became Jarl of Orkney, Percy said, his eyes wide. And you became a great warrior, an Ulfhethin, one of Odin's own warriors. What man doesn't want to be one of those? And now I'm nothing once again, Einar said with a snarl. I had barely time to warm the high seat of Orkney with my arse when Eirik Bloody Axe arrived with an army and stole it away from me. Then my wound rankled, and I ended up like this. He held up his injured hand once again. And what use is a wolf-coat warrior who cannot hold a weapon properly? He said, heaving a heavy sigh. Apart from that, as our bout just showed, the sickness has taken away all my stamina. You beat me easily. Einar, son of Thorfinn the Skullcleaver, bested by a fisherman's son. So much for the great warrior. He caught the look of consternation on Bercy's face and knew he should not let the dark bitterness that clouded around his own heart taint the other's young spirit. Sorry, Einar said. I don't mean to belittle your own effort in the fight. It's just that when you rise so high so fast, coming back down to earth again is hard to take. Einar, this time a few weeks ago you were flat on your back in bed, in the depths of the sweating and sickness, Percy said. We thought you'd never rise again. But here you are, back on your feet. You should be happy just to be alive. Who knows where you will be in another few weeks? Einar did not reply. He had a horrible feeling that the answer to that question was that he would still be stuck right here in Frodesborg. Percy looked at the practice sword. I still have your real sword, he said. The Princess Afreka gave it to me to keep for you until you got better. Do you want it back? The Ulfbert, Einar said, clenching his teeth. Keep it. Knives are fine, but any long blade just twists out of my grasp. Are you sure? Percy said, eyebrows raised. An Ulfbert sword is worth more silver than a Jarl's treasure hoard. I'm sure, Einar said. What good is it to me? I may as well have died the straw death in my sickbed. If I can't wield a sword or axe, I'm nothing. I'll look after it until you're better then, as Afreka asked me to, Percy said. How about we agree on that? I just might have need of it too. Eirik Bloody Axe has sent Vikings to ravage Norway. They say he's punishing us for driving him out of the kingship. Frostvik was burned to the ground only last week. That village is not far south of here. If Eric's Vikings come to Frodesborg, then with this sword, I'll be ready to stand against them.
I won't be much help if that happens, Einar said.
You're still the best skald I've ever heard, Percy said. The way you chant the old songs, Einar. I've never seen anyone who could captivate an ale hall the way you do.
Einar grunted, looking down at his injured hand again. The same wound means I can't pluck the strings of the harp properly, he said. It all sounds wrong. Notes are missing because of the missing finger. What use is a poet who cannot play his harp? Percy frowned. It was clear that the lad was beginning to get annoyed at Einar's black mood.
Einar, I can see why you're angry at what has happened to you, he said. But what good will this anger do you? You can't use it to fight anyone. The Norns, who govern all our fates, have put you where you are now. Do you think you can fight them? No. Even the gods' fates are determined by the Norns. Einar gaped, open-mouthed, astonished that words of such insight had come from a lad younger than him who had never left his home village except to go fishing. Now,
You want to try again? Bursi said, hefting his sword and shield into the defensive position. Maybe you'll beat me this time. Einar shook his head. Maybe if you let me win, he said. Besides, I've work to do. I should go back to the smithy. Einar stomped off across the meadow, leaving Bursi to tidy up the fighting gear as the first drops of a rain shower began to fall from a sky as grey as wolf fur. As he walked, he tried his best to dispel the black feelings that swirled inside him. But it was hard. The younger lad's words had disturbed Einar more than his beating him in the practice duel. Ulrich's Ulfhethner company had left him behind here in a little village in the back end of nowhere. He had no idea where they had gone. And if Eric's Vikings really did come, how could he even defend himself?
Chapter 2
Einar walked out of the meadow into the line of houses that made up the village. He was heading for a round building with a low thatched roof, which stood in contrast to the other long rectangular houses. It was the forge of Tostig the smith. At home in Iceland, they had a name for idle folk who liked to sit by the fire instead of working to help everyone else. Kolbiter, a coal biter. It was not a compliment. This was why, as soon as the old man Grimnir had nursed Einar with his herbs and potions through the worst of the sickness brought on by his poisoned wound, Einar had sought work. Tostig, the aging village blacksmith, had offered him employment doing odd jobs, and Einar had accepted. He was far from happy at being stuck in Frodisborg, but like any settlement in rough country where life was a constant struggle against weather, earth, and tides, he knew if he did not start to contribute in some way, the hospitality of the local folk would soon wear out. And right now, Einar had nowhere else to go. He had been in Frodisborg for many weeks now, and was beginning to worry that he would be stuck there forever. Einar should be Jarl of Orkney now. Instead, here he was, left behind in a sleepy village by Ulrich's Wolfcoat Company. And Orkney was Eric Bloodyaxe's new high seat of power, not Einar's. Ulrich's plan had been to sail to Norway and offer the services of his wolfcoats to the new king, Eric's younger brother and usurper, Hakon. They had, after all, common cause. Eric wanted Hakon dead as much as Hakon wanted Ulrich and his company dead. That was why they had arrived in Frodisborg, on the fjord-riddled western coast of Norway. It was the last place they had seen Hakon. Only now, he was no longer there and had moved further north. Then they had left Einar behind, due to the sickness brought on by his festering wound. The old man, Grimnir, with his wisdom of arcane lore, had eventually returned Einar to the land of the living. But the trouble was, now Einar had no idea where Hakon was, or how he might find him and Ulrich's crew. Even if he did, the wound poison had left him feeling weak as a child, and with his maimed hand. Would the wolfcoats even want him back? Did he even deserve to call himself one of them anymore? Over this last week or so, Einar had soon learned that the odd job Tostig had said he wanted him for actually meant doing most of the old man's work for him. After teaching Einar the basics of smithing, Tostig had taken to spending his days away from the hot darkness of the smithy, fishing and sleeping on the banks of the fjord at Ganvik, while Einar was left alone to finish the old man's tasks. Einar walked into the dark warmth of the forge, glad to be out of the ever-drizzling rain. He dropped his helmet and shield to the floor and prepared to get to work. Inside, the fire glowed, pouring out heat like the breath of a dragon. Before wandering off to his fishing that morning, old Tostig had left Einar a pile of broken tools to fix. Einar had left two shovel bales in the fire before he had gone to spar with Bursi, and now they glowed a hot cherry red and were ready for working. He picked up his special hammer and prepared to get to work. At first, a hammer had proved as impossible for him to wield as a long sword. But Tostig had taken one of his old hammers and cut the shaft in half. With the weight of the head closer to his hand, Einar found he was able to keep the much shorter tool more firmly in his weakened grasp. It was not totally under control, however. For added grip, Einar required a leather strap. Unfortunately, the same solution did not work with a full-size sword whose blade could not be cut in half. But at least this allowed Einar to work in the smithy. He set about winding the leather strap around his wrist, hand, and the shaft of the hammer. The final part, binding the strap in a knot, was the trickiest part, especially when he was on his own. He struggled to complete the knot, using his left hand in combination with his teeth. "Do you want help with that?" a female voice interrupted him. Einar started and looked around. His face flushed a crimson that had nothing to do with the heat of the forge. Standing in the doorway of the forge was a girl with long golden hair which she wore unbound in the custom of unmarried women. She was about 16 winters old, and by any standards, beautiful. She held a large clay jug in both hands before her. "My father said I should bring you some ale," the girl said, setting the jug down on a nearby bench, then joining Einar. "He said you would get thirsty working in the heat of the forge today." "Thank you, Frida," Einar mumbled, letting go of the strap with his teeth and grinning at the blacksmith's daughter like an idiot. "Your father has left me quite a lot of work to do." He felt as if he were frozen to the spot as Frida took the strap in her nimble fingers and tied it into a tight knot. When she finished, she looked up and smiled at him, locking her blue eyes with his for a moment. As she did so, Einar felt like the warm summer sun, something that there had not been much of this year, was shining directly on his face. "Thanks," was the best he could come up with to say. Frida nodded, turned and went to the door. "I have my own work to do," she said over her shoulder. "Perhaps we shall see each other later?"
"Definitely," Einar said, his grin spreading from ear to ear.
Then she was gone. For a moment, Einar stared after her. Then he sighed, realizing he needed to get to work himself. Pulling one of the red-hot bent shovel blades from the fire, Einar began pounding it back into shape. Sparks showered from the hot metal as the hammerhead crashed into it, sending the clangs of metal on metal through the air. Einar welcomed the work. Each blow of the hammer helped to dispel the clouds of frustration inside him. On top of all that, the work in the forge was helping him regain his strength. The shorter shaft meant the hammer had to be swung harder, and though strenuous movement might still leave him breathless, Einar's right arm had grown powerful already, even more than it had been before he was injured. By the time the shovel blade was knocked back into shape, he felt satisfied enough with his work that there was even a ghost of a smile playing on his lips.
He was sweating again, and his shoulder ached from the effort, but it was a warm, welcome tiredness.
As the clangs of the hammer died away in his ears, Einar became aware of other sounds. Somewhere distant, you could hear a horn blowing. He frowned. Grimnir lived in a house that was up on the mountain. From there, he had a view across the river valley and out into the fjord. He kept a horn for alerting the village if he saw any potential danger approaching. Could that be him? Then other horns were blaring. These much closer, from the village and its surroundings. Each one was insistent and warning. Within moments, they were joined by shouts and voices raised in consternation. He heard a woman scream and felt as though his heart had dropped through the bottom of his chest. Frida appeared in the doorway once more. Her eyes were wide and pleading. Her mouth worked as if she were trying to say something, but no words came out. She had both hands clasped around the blade of a spear that burst from the front of her dress. A huge red stain was spreading through her dress, centered on the spear. The rest of the spear shaft protruded from her back, she stood for a moment more. Then her eyes rolled up into her head, and she collapsed to the ground. Einar felt like a bucket of ice water had been thrown over his head. Frozen by shock, he stared down at the dead Frida. More shouting from outside broke the spell of horror. He looked to the doorway as a man from the village came running past outside. As Einar watched, astonished, another spear thudded into the man's back. It transfixed his torso, the blood-covered blade bursting from his stomach. With a startled cry, he fell, sprawling face forwards into the dirt. A girl of about 8 winters old came running behind the fallen man.
"Vikings!" she shouted. "Vikings are coming!"
Chapter 3. The warcraft training Skar Ulrich and the other Ulf Hethner had drummed into Einar finally took over. The shock at what was happening around him dissolved, loosening his frozen limbs. Amid the commotion outside, he saw a shadow fall across the threshold of the forge. Someone was coming. If he did not do something fast, Einar would join the dead lying outside. He jumped to one side of the door. He pressed his back to the wall. His hair scraped the thatch of the low roof as the rattling of ringmail and a thump of a wooden shield came closer. A warrior burst through the doorway. He wore a visored helmet. His torso was encased by the metal rings of a brynja, and in his right hand he grasped a sword, whose blade shimmered as it reflected the light of the forge. There was blood on the sword, and splashed across the shining rings of his brynja. In his left hand he carried a shield. Einar caught a glimpse of a design painted on it, but there was no time to work out what it was. The Viking roared a war cry at the top of his lungs, a scream that told of bloodlust and indiscriminate hatred. The man stopped, blinded for a moment as his eyes went from the brightness of daylight outside to the dark of the interior of the forge. Einar did not waste his chance. He smashed the hammer into the Viking's helmet. The heavy metal head crushed a huge dent in it, and one equally as large in the man's skull beneath. His war cry came to an abrupt end, and he dropped to the ground like a sack of grain whose bottom end had burst. He lay face down, body twitching and jerking in a way that told Einar the man was either dead, or at the very least would never rise again under his own power. Einar peeked out through the doorway. The scene that met his gaze was one of terror and chaos. Village folk ran this way and that, panic written over their faces. Warriors in helmets and shields, Viking raiders, ran among them, stabbing and hacking at anyone they could reach. Some were setting fire to the thatch of the buildings. At the little harbour beyond the village, two longships were beached, their dragon-carved prows rising high in the air like bloodthirsty jotnar, watching with pleasure the killing taking place before them. Grey smoke and the smell of burning was beginning to drift from flames that already licked the houses on the edge of the village. The sails of the longships and the shields of the Vikings all bore the same symbol, the bloody red axe of Eirik Haraldsson. The little girl was crouched over the body of the man who had fallen outside the door of the smithy. With a jolt, Einar realized the villager laying, unmoving, his torso transfixed by the spear, was Torfi, one of Bursi's fishing crew. The girl howling and pleading with him to get up was his daughter. Einar knew he had no time to waste. He grabbed his helmet with his left hand and plonked it on his head. There was no time to untie the strap that bound the hammer to his right hand, or to tie the straps of his helmet under his chin. With the cheek guards flapping loose, Einar lifted his shield and ran out of the forge. For a moment, he stopped, looking down at the corpse of Frida. She lay in a dark puddle of her own blood, her beautiful blue eyes open, fixed, and staring forever at the empty sky. Einar's eyes stung with sudden tears and felt a lump sticking in his throat. Then the cold fires of rage ignited in his heart. Einar felt it coursing through his veins like icy water.
He closed his eyes and gritted his teeth. Scar and the other wolfcoats had taught him he had to control the emotion. At all costs, he could not let himself go berserk, lose all control and run screaming straight out onto the spear points of the Vikings outside. He took a deep breath, struggling to channel the anger into action. He sensed the blood pounding in his arms and legs, driving away the tiredness. He took one last look at Frida, then stepped over her body and out the door of the forge. There would be time for mourning later. Now, it was time to fight. Einar looked around, taking in the calamity and bloodshed around him. A Viking was running straight towards the little girl huddled over the corpse of the speared man. His axe was raised to strike. He was screaming incoherently, his spittle flying in all directions. Einar stepped in between him and the girl. He raised his shield, countering the blow of the axe designed to chop the child in two. As the axe bit into the wood with a solid thunk, Einar swept the shield upwards, pushing the weapon away from the Viking's body. Then he struck with his hammer, catching the Viking on the right knee with a gut-churning crack of shattering bone. The man screamed in agony as his knee bent the wrong way. His leg collapsed under his weight, and he fell face forward onto the ground. Einar raised the hammer again and smashed it into the back of the Viking's head. He went limp in an instant. The little girl was now looking up, her face pale as snow, her eyes wide with shock and terror. "Get out of here," he shouted at her. "Run for the forest. You'll be safe there." The girl flinched at his words but did not move. Einar realized that towering over her, his face behind a visored helmet and brandishing a bloody hammer, he looked every bit as frightening as the Vikings who were running around destroying her village. There was no time to reassure her, however. He needed to get her away. Einar roared at her, raised his hammer and shield in an exaggerated fashion, and stepped towards her. It had some of his intended effect. The girl, now even more terrified, rose to her feet. Confused and afraid, she half turned to run, then stopped, perhaps thinking he would attack her when she turned her back.
"Go on! Get away!" Einar shouted.
He raised his right boot and planted a kick on her backside. Remorse stung him as in his anger and excitement he overdid it,
and the girl lifted off the ground a little from the force of his kick.
When she hit the ground again, however, she was running. This time she did not stop and ran as fast as the wind towards the meadow past the village and, to Einar's fervent hope, the relative safety of the trees beyond. Einar spun around to cover her flight. A running child would present a tempting, easy target to the Vikings. None saw her, however, and Einar realized that the Vikings were now occupied with something else.
The men of the village had got over their initial shock and were gathering at the end of one of the tracks that ran through the village, intending to confront the raiders.
Their war gear was old. Few had helmets. Some had shields, but many just had farming tools. Only one man wore a brynja, and it was an ancient one, with several holes and rusted rings of mail. They had enough shields, however, to form a wall across the track that led to the meadow. Behind them, the women, children, and elderly folk who had been able to get away fled towards the trees on the far side. Einar felt a thrill of excitement. The men of Frodisborg may have been simple farmers and fishermen, but they had been trained in warcraft by Ulrich's wolf warriors. They had held off the army of King Eric Bloody Axe's son Rognvald until Hakon had arrived with a horde of Jarl Sigurd of Hlada. These Vikings had picked the wrong village to raid. Einar ran to join their shield wall. Spotting Bursi, his sparring partner, near the middle of the formation, he took up a position beside him, adding his own shield to the defensive formation.
"Who's this come to help us? Thor?"
the man on Einar's right said, catching sight of the blood-splattered hammer strapped to Einar's hand. Bursi held up a sword. Despite the gloomy weather, The light shimmered across the blade, making it look like countless metal snakes twisting and turning around each other. There were runes used by the Christians embedded down the middle of it, spelling out Ulfbert, the name of the wizard smith who made these superb swords.
"Thanks for the sword, Einar," Bersi said. "Today, it will taste blood again."
"I didn't think you'd have to use it so soon," Einar said.
The Vikings left off their burning and looting and began to gather into a bunch before the villager's shield wall. Einar took another look at them, assessing the threat they posed. There were perhaps 40 of them, outnumbering the men of the village 2-1. If the Frodisborg men kept their discipline, however, they could hold the Vikings off long enough at least for the women and children to get away. As the Vikings formed up for attack, Einar noticed that the red axes painted on their shields appeared to have been daubed on in haste. The paint had run on some, and many had been splashed on over the existing symbols of stags, wolves' heads, or ravens. Whoever these warriors were, they seemed to be relatively recent recruits to the cause of Eirik Bloody Axe. Some of them bit the rims of their shields, and all had a fervid look in their eyes. They looked a wild bunch, and Einar began to fear that some of them may be berserkers, warriors blessed by the uncontrollable divine rage bestowed by Odin. A horn blew. With a roar, the Vikings launched their attack. It was not an ordered advance. Instead, it was a wild charge, every man sprinting as hard as he could towards the villagers' line of shields. "Remember what Ulrich and Skar taught you," Einar said to those around him in a loud voice as the Vikings closed the distance. "Stand firm, and we will force them back." Einar crouched behind his shield, setting his right foot back, bracing for the impact to come. The Vikings smacked into the shield wall in a clamor of screaming and the clatter of wood hitting wood. Einar felt the impact on his own shield ripple up his arm and through his left shoulder. The Viking on the other side shoved his spear over the top of Einar's shield, the point seeking Einar's face. Einar ducked left so the blade missed its target, and the shaft continued to slide over his right shoulder. Then he smashed the hammer down on the Viking's exposed hand where the man gripped his spear. The Viking cried out and let go of his weapon. Knowing he was momentarily safe from attack, Einar dropped his shield a little, surged forwards and brought the hammer down again, aiming for the Viking's helmet this time. The Viking ducked himself, but Einar's blow still connected, delivering a crushing blow to the man's left collarbone. He bellowed with pain and staggered back from the shield wall, his left arm dangling at an odd angle. Almost immediately, another Viking took his place. This one had a sword, which he put to use slashing and hacking at Einar. Einar counted 3 of his hits with his shield or hammer, then, when the Viking was about to strike a fourth time, raised his shield as the blow fell. The Viking's blade thudded into the top rim of his shield, and Einar struck it with his hammer. A dull clang rang out, and the sword bent, its top half curling down the back of Einar's shield. The Viking pulled his sword back, his mouth falling open as he stared in dismay at his now useless weapon. He stumbled back, turned and began to run back away from the villager's shield wall. Einar glanced to his left and right. He felt a swell of pride to see their shield wall still intact and solid, with 4 dead Vikings lying before it. The rest of the raiders, their initial ferocious assault halted, appeared to have lost their initial momentum and were retreating down the track.
"Good work, lads," Einar shouted. "We're winning."
Then Einar saw a figure emerge from behind the other Vikings. He swallowed, scarcely able to believe his own eyes. By any standards, the man was huge. Einar was a big enough lad, and Skar, the prowman of Ulrich's crew, was a head taller than him. This man was bigger again. He stomped through the crowd of Vikings, towering over them like a mountain ash amid heather bushes. He wore a brynja polished to gleaming, while around his shoulders was a cloak made from the white fur of an animal. That it had been a white bear was obvious, as the creature's head formed the hood of the cloak, which the Viking had pulled up over a helmet that glittered like silver, even in the dull rainy weather. A wide brown beard fell from beneath the helmet visor. It was cut straight across, midway down his massive chest, so it was shaped like a blade of a shovel. He carried a black shield, and alone among the Vikings his was not daubed with the red axe of Eirik. Instead, the snarling face of a bear, its teeth bared, was emblazoned in white. In his right hand, he held a sword. Einar judged that it must have been specially made for this giant of a man. A normal sword held in his meaty fist would have looked like little more than a long knife, but the weapon he carried was in proportion to the rest of him. Its long, wide blade shimmered and glinted in the pathetic sunlight.
"You useless sea scum,"
the giant said, haranguing the Vikings around him. Einar noticed that a couple of them flinched at the sound of the man's voice. It was clear that the big man was their leader.
"Can't you beat a pathetic bunch of fishermen? Let's finish this now."
The big Viking turned to face the villagers' shield wall.
"Folk of Frodisborg,"
he bellowed at the men crouching behind the protection of their shields.
"Eirik Bloody Axe has a message for those who have betrayed him. We are here to deliver it, with blades, fire, and death."
He hefted his shield into position and began lumbering towards the line of villagers' shields. As the other Vikings began to fall in behind him, the huge man in the white bear pelt picked up speed. A thunderous roar of pure rage burst from his lips as he charged. Einar felt his guts lurch as he realized the big man was running straight at him. Chapter 4. Einar clenched his teeth and prepared for the coming impact. He pushed forward his left shoulder, stiffened his left arm, and crouched in the cover provided by his shield. He pushed his right leg back to provide further bracing. He had to keep his head down behind his shield if he did not want to risk presenting a target for the enemy. While it meant he was protected, he could not see where the attacker was and could only guess how far away the big man was. He waited, every nerve in his body feeling like it was stretched to snapping point. What could only have been moments seemed to drag on and on. Even though he knew it was only in his own frenzied imagination, it was hard to dismiss the impression that the ground beneath his feet trembled with every thumping footstep of the giant Viking charging towards him. There was a crack like thunder as the shields met. The next thing Einar knew, he was off his feet and stumbling backwards. Unable to recover himself, he crashed down, landing flat on his back with a teeth-rattling impact. The back of his head struck the ground, and despite the protection given by his helmet, the world before him disappeared in a storm of countless multicolored spinning stars. Einar blinked, trying to clear his vision and dispel the astonishment mixed with shock at the sheer power of the man that flooded his mind. Einar had been swept aside like a dog before a charging bull. He felt cold air on his face and realized that his helmet, its straps untied, had rolled off his head after he hit the ground. He had a dim awareness of a small voice somewhere deep within his mind screaming to him to get up or he was dead. But for a moment he could not move. Then his sight cleared and he wished it had not. Looming over him was the terrible sight of the huge Viking in the white bear pelt, sword reversed, preparing to stab it down through Einar's face. Einar's paralysis dissolved. He swiped with his hammer at the only part of the Viking he could reach, the man's left foot. It connected. The Viking grunted and shifted his weight a little, but it did not stop him in his killing intent. The blade came down. At the last possible moment, Einar wrenched his head to the side. Combined with the Viking's change in stance, the movement was enough that the sword missed Einar, the point burying itself in the earth instead of his head. He felt the cold metal running across the side of his neck,
his flesh stung where the wicked sharp edge nicked it, and knew the Viking had only missed by a hair's breadth. For an instant, Einar had a close-up view of the big Viking sword, much closer than any normal person would ever want to have. He saw that, like his Ulfbert, there were runes set into the centre of the blade. They did not spell out Ulfbert, however. They were in the runes the Christians called their alphabet, and he could not read what they said. There was no time to try to, anyway. Einar rolled to his left, away from the Viking and up to his feet again. A quick glance told him that the big man had punched through the villager's shield wall like it was a line of scarecrows. The disciplined defensive formation was smashed, and the villagers were now fighting hand to hand with the Vikings, who had piled through the gap opened up by their leader. Einar hefted his shield into a ready position as the Viking wrenched his sword out of the earth. To Einar's dismay, he saw that the linden wood of his shield was now cracked from the impact of the big Viking's charge. To his further consternation, the metal band that ran around the rim to hold the shield together came apart with a ping and fell to the ground. The shield disintegrated like the villager's shield wall, leaving Einar gripping only the metal boss. Several of the villagers recognized that the fight was lost and started to run. Their flight meant that they had to get past the Viking leader, who was now between them and the meadow beyond the village. The big Viking had his sword out of the ground now and swiped at them as they tried to run past. One of the fleeing villagers was the man who wore the old brynja, and the Viking's blade tore through its metal rings as if they were made of wool. The sword opened up a huge wound in the man, almost cutting him in half at the waist. He cried out, stumbled, and dropped to the ground. Einar heard screaming and turned to see one of the other Vikings coming straight at him, axe raised. He hurled his shield boss at the man. The bowl-shaped metal boss caught the Viking full in the face. The man's belligerent yelling ceased. He dropped his shield, his left hand going to his smashed teeth and nose, as his headlong charge turned into a wobbling stagger. Einar stepped forward and hit him across the head with his hammer. The man went down. Bursi yelled a war cry and swung the Ulfbert at the Viking leader. The big man blocked the blow with his shield, then counterattacked with his own sword. The blade swooped through the air, the force of the man's arm and its own momentum causing the steel to flex in the air. It lashed downward like a metal whip, and Einar was reminded of one of the kennings the poets used to describe swords as the serpents of battle.
Bursi raised his own sword to counter the attack.
The blades met in a tremendous ring like the noise made by the Christian's bells. Bursi's arm was forced down, but he managed just to stop the deadly blow. Bursi staggered back to create space between himself and his opponent as the Viking struck again. Again the blade scythed down, and Bursi blocked it once more with his sword. This time, the sound when the swords met was a dull clang. Before Einar's astonished gaze, he saw the Ulfbert's sword, the finest weapon to be made on this Middle Earth, break in half, leaving Bursi holding only a stump. Bursi's own incredulity froze him, and he was still gazing in disbelief at the broken sword in his hand when the Viking leader stabbed him through the throat. Several buildings were now burning, and smoke billowed around the fighting men in the village track. Despite this, Einar could see that for the men of Frodisborg, the fight was over and the battle lost. Their shield wall broken, many of them were dead. Some were fleeing and the remainder were fighting with the Vikings to get the chance to run. The time had come for Einar to run too. He could stay and make a glorious, futile final stand, but it was against everything Ulrik and Skar had taught him.
"If the situation is hopeless, but you can get away, do it," Ulrik had said. "Odin teaches us that even a cripple is more useful than a great warrior on his funeral pyre. A corpse is no use to anyone."
The big Viking leader was busy swiping and stabbing at those villagemen unlucky enough to be within striking distance as they tried to run away. This could be Einar's only chance. He turned and ran for the meadow,
Einar!
Amid the throng, he heard someone shout his name. He stopped again and looked in the direction the voice had come from. There was a man standing between two of the longhouses that lined the track into the village. He had very long white hair and beard, both of which were combed straight and smooth and flowed like an avalanche over his shoulders. He had a long walking staff grasped in one hand. It was Grimnir, the wise old man of the village who had sailed with Einar and the Wolfcoats on several of their expeditions, and who had nursed Einar back to health. Seeing he had caught Einar's attention, Grimnir cocked his head in a gesture that Einar should follow him, then turned and hurried off between the two houses. Einar glanced around to see if any of the Vikings were watching. By luck, a thick cloud of dark smoke drifted over the trackway, hiding him from view. Einar switched direction and ran between the houses after the old man. With impressive speed for an old man, Grimnir jogged out the back of the houses and hopped into the undergrowth beyond. To his consternation, Einar realized Grimnir was leading him towards the shore of the fjord. Everyone else from the village was fleeing inland, towards the forest on the other side of the meadow and the many hiding places it offered.
"When you're caught by a riptide or current that is too strong to fight," the old man said over his shoulder, "the best thing to do is swim sideways."
They pushed their way through the ferns and gorse until they entered the short strip of fir trees that lined the edge of the fjord at Gandvik. In a small creek, a little sailing boat, a karfa, capable of carrying 5 or 6 people, was beached. Grimnir clambered in.
"Push us off, if you please, Einar," the old man said. "I need your strength. Then the oars."
Einar held up his right hand, which still had the hammer lashed to it. Grimnir nodded and leaned over to untie the leather strap. Einar felt a brief twinge in his heart at the thought that the last fingers to touch the strap had been Frida's. Then his hand was free of the hammer, and Grimnir set to work unfurling the sail, while Einar shoved the boat out into deeper water. When he had waded up to his waist and the karfa was fully afloat, Einar dragged himself over the side and took a seat on the middle one of the 3 rowing benches. He pushed the oars out either side and began to strain his shoulders and back as he pulled out long, even strokes that soon had the boat gliding along out into the waters of the fjord and away from Frodesborg.
"Do you think this is wise?" he said over his shoulder to Grimnir. "Those Vikings have 2 longships."
"They'll be too busy burning and looting to bother with us," the old man said.
Facing backwards, Einar saw the columns of thick black smoke rising from beyond the trees. Frodesborg was ablaze. "Eirik has delivered his message," Einar said, remembering the words of the huge Viking leader. "There's no mistaking that."
"Well, you did kill his bastard son here," Grimnir said.
He sat at the back of the boat, one hand on the steering oar and the other tugging on a rope attached to the sail as he tried to catch the wind.
"We shouldn't be surprised he chose to hit back here."
The sail snapped tight as the wind filled it. The boat surged forward faster than Einar could propel it with the oars, so he pulled them back on board. He watched as the burning village receded in their wake, thinking of Frida and all the others who had died there both today and when Eric's son Rockenvald had attacked it earlier in the year.
"What was it all for, Grimnir?" Einar said.
The old man raised an eyebrow.
"We trained the men of Frodesborg to fight. We fought side by side with them in a battle and saved the village," Einar said with a sigh. "We killed Rockenvald. So many fought and died. Now it's burning."
"It's just buildings that are burning," Grimnir said. "They can be rebuilt. A village is the folk who live there, not the daub, wattle and thatch they live in."
"A lot of those folk died today," Einar said, his voice laden with bitterness.
"The stand of the men of Frodesborg allowed the rest of the village to escape," Grimnir said. "Vikings by nature raid and leave. The folk can come back to Frodesborg and rebuild it.
Einar was quiet for a moment as their boat sailed on down the fjord towards the sea beyond. "Did you see that man who led them?" he said after a time, feeling an involuntary shiver at the memory of the big man wrapped in the white bear pelt. "He was huge. That sword of his broke my Ulfbert. It must be a magic weapon." Grimnir made a face.
"Often when men don't understand something, they call it magic," he said. "Perhaps it is. Perhaps it is just very well made."
"I wonder who will feel Eric's anger next," Einar said.
"I suspect many folk along the Norway coast will be raided by these men," Grimnir said. "We need to warn King Hakon. We will sail north."
"You know where Hakon is?" Einar said. "Why didn't you tell me? Ulrik and the others will be with him, a Freka too."
"There are still many in Norway who oppose King Hakon," Grimnir said. "He's not yet completely secure on the high seat of the land. And we don't want Eric finding out where he is either. So I thought it best not to let anyone know. Now it seems I have no choice but to let you into the secret."
"So where is he?" Einar said.
"He is in the northwest part of the country," Grimnir said. "He should be at Dale, among the Fialar folk. He is travelling around meeting the ordinary people so they can see their new king, and know he is now in charge. Jarl Sigurd is paying your wolf-coated friends to keep Hakon safe while he is there. We will sail there and warn him of this danger. I hope Ulrik has done his job and the lad is still alive."
Chapter 5. Dale, in the folksland of Fjala, northwestern Norway.
"What I don't understand," Wolfhelm the Saxon said, pointing a wavering forefinger at a Freka, "is why a good-looking girl like you isn't married."
His voice slurred a little, and an extra moustache of ale foam sat on top of his usual long, drooping blonde one. A Freka was sitting across the table from him. She was lounging back on her bench, legs crossed at the ankles, feet on the table. She scowled at Wolfhelm's words and looked away, then lifted her own ale horn and took a swig.
"Don't you wonder about this too, Surt?"
Wolfhelm, undaunted, used his finger to prod the meaty forearm of Surt, who sat, arms folded, beside him.
"It's not a surprise to me,"
Surt said.
"Look at her, sitting here in a tavern, feet up on the table drinking ale. Who would marry a woman like that?"
The three of them sat at a table in the alehouse of the settlement at Dale. Dale was a little village at the top of a fjord in northwest Norway, and although it was currently hosting a visit by the new King Hakon, very little of consequence happened in this sleepy little backwater. There was not much danger for Ulrik's wolfcoats to protect Hakon from, and Freka and the others found their biggest challenge was finding enough to do to fill their days before retiring to the settlement's single tavern to dispel their boredom with ale. Despite supposedly being dedicated to hospitality, the tavern was not the most inviting of places. The floor was covered in filthy straw that bore the sour reek of vomit and spilled ale. The tables were unwashed and sticky. The fire remained unlit. The room was gloomy at the best of times. But as the grey, rain-sodden sky outside darkened towards evening, it was becoming almost too hard for the drinking companions to make out the features of their fellows.
Freka wore the pelt of a wolf around her shoulders, while the other two wore heavy wool cloaks.
They were all part of Ulrik's crew, but only Freka was an initiated Ulfhethin, one of Odin's own wolf warriors. Freka swept her feet off the table and leaned forward.
"I am the daughter of the King of Dublin, Sirklander," she said. "You would do well to remember that."
"A king's daughter who wears men's boots, leather breeches, and a leather jerkin that still bears the rust stains of the brynja she often wears over it,"
Surt said, a faint smile on his lips.
"Forgive me, but she does not look like a high-born lady who could run a great man's estate and feasting hall. A lady who might burn one down, on the other hand, yes.
Ah, but look at that pure skin, the lovely red hair.
Those eyes, Wolfhelm rambled on, his gaze dropping to a point well below Afreka's eyes.
If she was cleaned up, she would grace the hall of any king or thane. She could serve the ale at the table of the highest of kings, don't you think?
I think,
Surt said, pulling the drinking horn away from Wolfhelm's befuddled grasp.
You've had too much ale.
Give me that back, Wolfhelm said, swiping to reclaim his horn, a look of mock dismay on his face. Did it ever occur to you, Afreka said, that the idea of being married off to stop some war, then spending the rest of my day serving beer to tables full of drunken oafs like you, may not appeal to me that much?
What else would a noble woman want? Wolfhelm said, his face clouded by a puzzled expression.
It's considered the highest honour for a woman.
Perhaps I'm just strange, Afreka said. But sailing the whale roads as part of one of the most dangerous crew of warriors in this Middle Earth is somehow more attractive a proposition.
Anyway, why would I have to be the one serving the ale instead of being served? Why couldn't I rule in my own right?
Wolfhelm and Surt looked at her, open-mouthed.
Because you're a woman?
Wolfhelm said, as if it were the most obvious thing in the world.
There are women who rule, Afreka said. Not many, I grant you. But you Saxons had a queen. One of Elfred's daughters. Didn't she rule by herself?
Wolfhelm pursed his lips. Surt looked at him, expectant of a rebuttal, but the Saxon shrugged instead.
Ethelfled, Lady of the Mercians, he said. I grant you that one. She was quite a lady. She kicked your lot's asses anyway.
My lot, Afreka said.
The Danes,
Wolfhelm said, taking advantage of Surt's astonishment that a woman had ruled a kingdom to snatch back his ale horn.
She stopped them taking Castir and captured Derby from them.
You people are so ignorant, Afreka said, scowling again.
They weren't even Danes who attacked Castir. They were Ostmen from Ireland, my clan, the sons of Ivar. We honour her name as a valiant enemy.
The doors banged open, spilling some of the remaining daylight into the tavern. Starkad and Carry, two of their fellows in Ulrich's wolfcoat crew, came in.
Both were tall and walked with the easy athletic pace of men who spend most of their time rowing, fighting, or practicing to fight. Starkad's long blonde hair and beard were braided, while Carry's brown hair was shorn very short over most of his head. Except for two long tails that were wound around the top of his head and tied in a knot just to the right of his crown. He had runes tattooed across his face in black ink and looked a little like a bird had left its footprints over his cheeks. Both wore around their shoulders the wolf pelt cloak of an Ulfhethin. Starkad's pale blue eyes surveyed the miserable tavern as he sat down at the table with the others.
Another wild night in Dale, eh? He said. I'm not sure I can live much more with this excitement.
Carry whistled to the alewife who ran the tavern. She was a formidable lady, in the middle years of life, who looked like, if pushed to wrestle any of the men in her tavern, she would win. The look she shot at Carry as he waggled Wolfhelm's now empty ale horn at her would have curdled milk.
Are you going to light some torches or lamps?
Starkad said, as she waddled over, cradling a large jug of ale before her in both hands.
It's getting so dark in here, we can hardly see enough to bite our own fingers.
Torches cost silver,
the alewife said, pouring horns of ale for all of those at the table.
Maybe if you lot ate some of the food I sell instead of your own fingers, it might be worth my while lighting a lamp.
She turned to Carry to fill the ale horn he held, giving him a wink as she poured the foaming liquid.
Though you can eat whatever you want in here, big lad, free of charge, she said.
Despite the gloom, the others noticed Carrie turn a shade paler. As the alewife flounced off, all at the table raised their horns in salute to each other.
Athelflaed was exceptional, though,
Wolfhelm said, resuming the earlier conversation.
Athelflaed of the Mercians, Starkad said. My grandfather fought against her. A hard-nosed bitch by all accounts.
An exceptional woman for exceptional times,
Wolfhelm said, his ale horn wavering before him.
And these times aren't, Afreka said. Ulrik is convinced that Ragnarok, the end of the world, is coming.
He does, doesn't he?
Wolfhelm said.
He seems obsessed. I worry he's so desperate for glory that he's going to get us all killed.
There's not much chance of that, Carrie said with a grunt. This place is quieter than the grave.
Maybe Ulrik is right, Afreka said. There's something strange going on. Look at the weather.
I don't recall ever a time like this when there was no summer.
Hakon clearly doesn't seem worried about it,
Surt said.
He's travelling around these backwaters like he's going to live forever.
Well, why wouldn't he? Wolfhelm said. He's a Christian, like me. He knows the world will end when Christ returns, not when heathen gods battle monsters.
Hush! Don't say such things so loud, Afreka said, her eyes darting around the room. If the locals find out you're a Christian, we'll have a fight on our hands.
Relax, Starkad said. There's no one here to overhear us, except maybe Carrie's girlfriend over there.
I don't know about you, Wolfhelm said, but I'm getting so bored here I would welcome a fight. Why is Hakon wasting time in this place anyway?
Hakon is engaged in what they call statecraft, Carrie said, clearly keen to change the subject.
Scar taught me about it. Eirik Bloodyaxe was rightful king of Norway. He was granted power by his father, Harald.
But rightful heir or not, Eirik was a tyrant, Afreka said.
Aye, he was, Carrie said. Who knows that better than us? Who used to keep that tyrant on his throne?
He shot a knowing smile in Starkad's direction.
And what gratitude did he show us for that work? Starkad said. Nothing but betrayal. Anyway, Carrie continued, because Hakon drove the rightful king out of Norway, tyrant or not, his position is still not a strong one. He needs as much support as he can gather, and many districts have still not seen him. So, if push came to shove and Eirik were to return with an army, why would those folk support Hakon? So he's travelling all around the country talking to the common folk and gaining their confidence to ensure their support. And the boy is good at that,
Surt said.
He's such a likable person. I've never seen someone with such a gift.
The folk who meet him all love him, Afreka said, nodding. They say it's like Harald Fairhair's returned, somehow grown young.
Starkad tutted.
Harald was an old bastard too. Every bit the tyrant Eirik was, he said. Anyway, there's no one in this district but bonded labourers and low-born farmers. What use are they to kings? They don't command armies. They can't provide brynjas and swords. We're here to protect him, but what danger is he in from the peasants around here?
When it comes to war, it's these folk who make up most of the army, Afreka said. Hakon's father, Harald, took the ancestral odal rights of inheritance away from the commoners and bondsmen. It was by promising to give them back that Hakon won their support. That was how he chased Eirik Bloodyaxe out of Norway.
But we're warriors, not nursemaids,
Starkad said.
And these folk wouldn't lift a finger against Hakon. Everyone loves the lad. He's got the gift. That would change fast if the ordinary folk knew Hakon was a Christian,
Carrie said. The expression on his face suggested he was not too happy with the fact either.
I hope Ulrich knows what he's doing in giving Hakon our support.
That's why you need to keep your voice down when you say such things,
Afreka said, glancing around again.
Carrie, get your girlfriend over here,
Starkad said, holding up his already empty horn.
I need more ale.
Carrie frowned, but the alewife had already spotted Starkad's gesture and was trundling over with the jug of beer.
Thirsty, lads? That's what I like to see, she said,
refilling Starkad's horn and topping up the others, regardless of whether they were ready for more or not.
I could do with the custom tonight.
So, where is everybody anyway?
Starkad said.
This place isn't exactly lively of an evening, but there's usually a few locals in. Tonight it looks like there is a feast or party going on somewhere else that we've not been invited to.
Haven't you heard the rumours?
The alewife said. Her face became serious, and she leaned closer, speaking in a low, conspiratorial voice, even though there was no one else to overhear.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.